Well, you might think it's a bit dry, and it could be very dry, I don't know. You know, this guy doesn't think too much of it. I was very aware that this is on the Facebook page of the Bavard Bar. Come and speak and be inspiring. So I will do my best. I have a passion, it's all about passion. I have a passion for ideology, but it's really more a passion against ideology. All my life I've had a serious problem. As Tim did say, I'm neurodiverse, I have ADHD, and my tribe, for some reason, likes change. We like things to move, we like things to be different. So anything to do with ideology, fixed ideology, is a problem. Also, I'm not getting on with this. It's connected with my upbringing in a Christadelphian church. I don't know if anyone knows the Christadelphian church. It's a small sort of sect. I was kind of hijacked by my parents when I was young. And we used to meet in a little hall like this. We used to have these little notice boards to encourage people to come to the lectures. We called them strangers, get the strangers in, because, you know, we could convert them. So this was also a problem. There's about 50,000 worldwide, so it's not a very big organisation. And this picture here represents being saved at the end of the world. And they thought they were the only ones. I don't know if they still think that, but they did think that at the time. And I couldn't quite understand, because I wasn't one of them. I was a child, and you could only join when you were grown up. So there was this kind of problem, you know, what would happen to me? And it was a bit scary, to be honest. I was talking to a couple of people over here, and they do counselling for people like me, so quite good. Now, this is also the kind of thing I had to put up with. I showed you that little notice board that gets the strangers in, you know, these strange other people. And we used to have them outside our house as well, which was very embarrassing. Now, this is a genuine invitation to a lecture. I don't know if you can read it. Nobody seemed to notice, because, you know, Brother Denton. Because we could be brothers, we were brothers, Brother Deadman. And you didn't actually, nobody realised a dead man, a dead man. So, because everyone's laughing, you know, and my friends are kind of, you know, it was difficult. Growing up was quite difficult. Ideology. I don't like it. I've never liked it. I've always had a problem with it. Wikipedia. I know, you know, you're not supposed to do this, but it's a good definition, and it has these lovely, you know, links you can check, meanings of words. You know the meanings of these words? I don't know. I know the meaning, but I couldn't explain them. And of course, Wikipedia will do it for you. So there you go. Epistemic is about knowledge. Normative is about what's good and bad. Beliefs, very interesting. Notice, a view you hold without any evidence. Isn't that fascinating? So, here's a definition in accessible communication format. I should point out, accessible communication format is a sort of government bureaucratic thing, which is about making things easy to read. So they use a very extraordinary accessible communication format title. All right? So, there we go. That's my definition. A collection of arbitrary beliefs that people hold for no particular reason, but nevertheless believe that others should hold and adhere to as well, just because they say so. That's why I've always had a problem. I don't know if, you know, well, whatever, you make your minds up. So this was me growing up, confused. I think I built a picture of why. I found everything incomprehensible, and I found people incomprehensible, and I had this habit of calling incomprehensible people stupid. And my parents, especially my father, had a serious problem with that. I suppose because it was something to do with dissing authority. I'd come home from school and say, all the teachers are stupid, or why are the teachers so stupid? Why are doctors stupid? But we'll come on to that. So this word stupid went into my vocabulary. It's still there. I try not to use it too much, but I am in good company, as you know, because he muttered it, apparently. And I have great sympathy for Mr. Corbyn on this issue. He was under severe pressure. Where are we? Keep going. No, there we go. Now, this is a guy called Edward. I've highlighted in red all his qualifications. Notice he's not just any old bod. He's someone who is very well educated. He's a professor at the University of Cambridge. He's got all sorts of letters after his name. He's a neuropsychiatrist, neuroscientist, whatever. Anyway, he studied at Barts Hospital. I'm sure you've all heard of Barts. There it is. Wonderful place. It was started by a monk who was also a minstrel 900 years ago, so that's quite interesting. So it's an eminent place, and all sorts of eminent medical minds trained at Barts Hospital, you can imagine, over the years. This guy here isn't one of those. This guy is actually a window, not a window cleaner, sorry. I apologize to any window cleaners present. Now, he's a chimney sweep, and one of the eminent physicians had a disease which was very prevalent amongst chimney sweeps. And there were many, many, many... anyway, we'll move on. You get the picture. Now, there was a kind of a motto for people at who'd been trained at Barts, that is, you can always tell a Barts man, but you can't tell him much. In other words, if you had been trained there, you were incapable of listening. Now, this is the bit that I really like. This is what endeared me to Edward in a book that I was reading. He was taught all of this stuff. It was rammed into his head. All of this stuff which there was... Excuse me, I need a glass of water. It was all rammed in his head as absolute gospel, something that you couldn't argue with. And yet, 35 years later, I suppose it is, he's constantly able to say, that is wrong, okay? And, hang on. Thanks, Fiona. So, I think you know what, you can see where I'm going with this. Where I'm going is stupid people. And the stupid people are the people who think they are always right, in my book. Now, here's another guy. His name is Stephen. He popped up on the internet. He's at a university in Miami, and he said some very interesting things. Critical thinking, constant questioning of your beliefs. He said, constantly examining the evidence, arguments, and reasons for beliefs. He said, self-deception and deception of yourself by others are two of the most common human failings. And then he went on to say, self-deception often goes unrecognized because most people deceive themselves. So, on my journey doing this this talk on ideology, I realized that actually we're all stupid, including myself, and I'm not quite sure, or I wasn't at this point, quite sure what to do about it. There's me. Someone said that to someone, but I'm not sure who. And David Gray, I don't know if anyone of you have heard of Liminal Thinking. It's a wonderful book, and there is a wonderful 10-minute video which introduces it, which I will sort of show you. His three principles, and there's always principles in a long book, these principles, very simple: get in touch with your ignorance, seek understanding, and do something different. Okay, those are the principles. So, the video starts a little bit like this. Reality is the unknowable. In other words, we have no idea what reality is because we're just not programmed to do that. So what we do is we look around us, we use our experiences, we use our observations, and from that, we pick the things which are relevant to our needs. Then, on the basis of that, notice the little blocks are getting smaller here, on the basis of that, we make assumptions. And then on the basis of the assumptions, we draw conclusions. And then, away miles from reality, we form our beliefs. And there we are, standing on the top of the pyramid. That's our reality. And it's an awful long way from the reality which we've got no idea about anyway. And we all think it's obvious. Okay, what we know is obvious, and we can't understand why what other people know is ridiculous. The problem is that there are other people, and they've all got their same little pyramids, and they sit on the top there, and they have very different beliefs. And in order to understand the other beliefs, you have to go right down, understand where they're coming from, understand where you're coming from as well, and get back up to what they think. Now, in the video, this is a shot from the video. It all gets quite complicated. He talks about self-seeing logic. He talks about external validity, internal coherence, and this, that, and the other. But I would really recommend that you watch the video. It's 10 minutes. It's a kind of meditation because it's slow, but it's very, very interesting. And, of course, you could read the book if you really want to. So, there's a blank room. The thing is, we now, or I've convinced myself at least, that none of us know anything very much, and that our beliefs are totally arbitrary. So where do we go from there? And how do we update our beliefs? I think the problem is that we're afraid of change. I wouldn't say I'm afraid myself, because I've got ADHD, but that's another story. And of course, if you look at this blank room, we sort of can see why we're afraid, because if this was a horror movie, some awful thing would be happening, there would be blood splattering everywhere. But instead of that, what I'm going to do is bring you some hope in the form of another book, because I do love books. This is Active Hope, How to Face the Mess We're In Without Going Crazy. And this is what it says in sort of distilled down. The kind of response we make and the degree to which we believe they count are shaped by the way we think and feel about hope. In other words, we're in control and we do have power. And we need, in order to have power, we need a mental shift from power over, which is power as a commodity, involving taking away from others, fostering mental rigidity, which of course leads to rigid ideology, and generates feelings of powerlessness, which of course is how most of us feel these days because of Brexit. So, power with, which is what this book talks about, is working together, emergence and synergy, new possibilities and capacities, in other words, sharing beliefs, alchemy of shared ideas, moving on. So, what I'm talking about really is getting away from rigid ideology and updating our beliefs and not being scared. This is, of course, the world we live in, a world where you have these binary things going on. You've got Europe for and against, you've got trans rights for and against, you've got Israel for and against, and endless other for and against. So it is really important that we take stock and figure out why this is happening. So my conclusion really is that I'm wrong in thinking that ideology is bad. It's not that it's bad, it's part of the human condition, but the important thing is that we update our ideology on a regular basis. So I'm going to leave you with a couple of quotes. This one from Anne Landers. Anne Landers actually doesn't exist. She's it's a made-up name, but presumably somebody wrote the quote. Anyway. And of course, a lot of people have dogs here, so I'm a little bit concerned about their welfare. And finally, this is my favourite quote of all time, so I will leave you just to read that and ponder on it. It's one of the greatest writers of, excuse me, all time, and I think it sums up what I've been trying to say. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. So, what a fabulous start to 2019. I think sums up my position in life, basically, which is that I know nothing, and that's always been abidingly clear. But brilliant, Rod. Thank you ever so much. Now, at this point, I throw the bravado to the audience, a bit like a gladiatorial lion. Not really. Don't worry. But does anybody have any questions for Rod and liminal thinking? And was that a hand? Was that yes, here, Andrew.
Good evening. I've worked in various monolithic institutions where the phrase resistance to change is used as a sort of derogatory insult. Is there any other type of insult? Are there any situations where change is bad, or like this kind of endless acceptance of change can be a bad thing?
Sorry, I actually missed what they said in these monolithic
Resistance to change.
So yeah.
If they say, "Oh, we're going to do this now," and you say, "Well, that's a bad idea," and they say, "Well, you're resistant to change."
Well, change is a funny, slippery concept, like so many things, and change can be good and bad. The change that I'm talking about is the willingness, basically, to listen to other people, listen to their arguments, and update on that basis, not change for the sake of it. So instead of those groups shouting at each other and not listening, that we saw earlier, actually listen to what the other person says and try to find some common ground, I guess. So it's that kind of change. Instead of fixed ideologies, it's saying, hang on, I think that, but that person just said something very sensible. Maybe I need to just update what I think a little bit. Okay?
Yeah, that's great. Well, by me. any other questions for Rod and liminal thinking and change or no change or no questions?
Well, I'm here.
Oh, where? Sorry. Oh, but hand wave. I'm going to run over here. Yes.
Thank you, Rob. This is very good. I'd be very interested to know what you think is the worst ideology that is currently assailing us as a nation at the moment.
Well, I would say actually assailing the world. My top bad ideology is neoliberalism. That's my view. And of course it's an interesting one in terms of Brexit, because people like Corbyn, I don't know if you know, he has deep reservations about Europe because they are quite neoliberal. It's a genuine reservation, but it doesn't mean to say it's not better to work with them. But anyway, I don't want to get into all that stuff.
It is only the start of 2019. But, yeah. Any other questions for Rod and liminal thinking and ideologies no, I think that's it for now. So can we thank Rod for a fabulous blabber?
Thank you.